Dallas Fort Worth, AALAC, the Chasing Your Dream Book Tour and Expo is coming to your area. Mark your calendars, May 18th, 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. Central Standard Time. We have some amazing authors, some amazing business owners that's going to be sharing about their brand. We have some workshop facilitators that's going to be coming out. They're going to be teaching on branding, marketing, and networking. I want you to plan to be in the building, to be educated, empowered, and encouraged. Come out, support.
Aspiring Authors Magazine is a founding sponsor for Da Crew Podcast. Get featured inside the magazine and allow your voice to be heard around the world.
Aspiring Authors Magazine is an international magazine founded in May of 2020 by Queen Angela. Get featured.
At Wings of Transformation Publishing, we are committed to helping our authors reach their goals and pursue their dreams of becoming published authors. We work closely with each author to ensure a successful publishing experience, and we are dedicated to helping them tell their stories in the most meaningful and impactful ways. We look forward to putting you on the path to writing your book.
Got 60 seconds? Take a mental health minute to learn about depression disorders. They cause symptoms that affect how you feel, how you think, and how you handle daily life. Depression should be treated by health professionals. Don't try to handle it alone or treat it with alcohol or illegal drugs. Treatments include psychotherapy or talk therapy, medication, and sometimes brain stimulation therapy. These treatments may also be used in combination with one another. If you think you might have depression, talk to a trusted friend, family member, or healthcare provider. The earlier treatment begins, the more effective it is. Learn more about depression through the NIMH website and take 60 seconds to share this mental health minute to help someone else.
Nursing me. All things ain't what they used to be now. Where did all the blue skies go? Poison is the wind that blows from the north and south and east. Oh, mercy, mercy me. All things ain't what they used to be now.
Good evening and welcome to Believe in the Journey podcast, where I am your host, Triveda Harris. And to all of the mothers, I want to say happy Mother's Day and thank you for taking the time to tune into tonight's show.
Before we do anything, you know, I always have to go to God in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for bringing us together as you do each and every Sunday that we come together. Please let the words of my mouth be comforting to the ears that are listening tonight. Those who are celebrating Mother's Day like myself without their mother for the first time, please give them the comfort that they need to get through this day. We know that you love us more than anything else, and you loved your children best, which is why you brought them home. In your precious and holy name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Tonight, I have a husband and wife who are here with me, and they're going to talk about how they fought their battles with Jesus. But I'm going to give you a brief little introduction of Mr. and Mrs. Mick and Tammy Simmons. They are a husband and wife team from Eastern Kentucky, and they are the founders of Free at Last Ministries. They committed their lives to Jesus Christ in the year 2000, and since then they have served in youth ministries and teaching the Word of God. They specialize in spiritual warfare and the deliverance of ministry. Their heart's desire is to help people grow and be all that they can be in the kingdom of God. So please welcome my guests, Mick and Tammy Simmons.
Hello.
Hello.
Hey. Listen, you know, as I told y'all before we even got started, that the technical difficulties are going to happen. And that's what happened. So I'm using my phone again. Like, it was fine just having a little conversation. And then all of a sudden, like, I could not even type to respond. To you guys, like, it would not do anything, like, it completely locked up. But yes, nonetheless, we're still gonna do what God has called us to do tonight, and we are gonna share your journey. And I'm gonna share a little bit about mine, and also my asthma is trying to get involved too, so I've had to use my inhaler while we were getting through this technical difficulties. But we will not be defeated, because God has the final say. The devil has no place. So
amen.
All right. Tell me a little bit about you guys. You know, I read your introduction, but I want you to introduce yourselves to the audience as well.
Well, first of all, we want to thank you for this opportunity to be a part of your podcast. It's our very first one that we're actually.
Wow.
We're on the other side of the interview or talk.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Well, thank you guys for accepting my invite to be on the show. And I'm honored to be your first host, I guess.
Yeah.
But going back, the way that I was introduced to spiritual warfare as a child growing up in Eastern Kentucky, I was a product of bullying. And a small town, back when I was a child, there wasn't very many things to entertain yourself.
Right.
So being bullied in school, during the weekends and things, we would always watch scary movies, and scary movies always have things to do with the occult and witchcraft and all that stuff. My parents never really did and go to church a lot, but one thing that I really want to encourage grandmothers in, I can honestly say that I know I'm here today because of the prayers of my grandmothers. On one side, I had a an old-fashioned Baptist grandmother that, I mean, she was hardcore. And on the other side, I had a fire-walking Pentecostal, you know. walking. So I had the best of both worlds. Going through all that, at first it's like, always as a child, I always knew there was a God, because, like, you know, I was an only child. So when I would go outside to play by myself, it's like, I would find myself a lot looking into the heavens, talking to God.
Right.
And I know it sounds crazy to the world, but sometimes I felt like he talked back to me.
And yeah, he definitely answers you back. And that's when you know that you're talking to God.
Yeah. And, but when I went through the bullying process, you know, I started to question everything. And, you know, with the entertainment choices I had growing up as a child, I actually turned to the other side. I got involved in playing with the Ouija boards, and I was, because in my heart, I kind of felt like God wasn't, he didn't have my back. And it's like, kind of like the woe is me, like, where are you, God? And like, during all this. But so it's like, well, I thought, well, I know what I'll do, like any brat child will do. They start to rebel. It's like, well, I'll just go play a Ouija board and you know, see what I can get done on the other side. And the weird thing was, it's like,
daredevil.
You know, the Bible says that there is pleasure in sin for a season. And in a period of time that I did that, it seemed like everything fell into place. And so, you know, as being young and naive, I thought, well, this stuff is really working. It's like, I really thought I was something. But
the devil blesses people too, and people don't understand that.
That's right. Yeah. But the thing I didn't realize is I opened a door that, you know, it's fun for a while, but what you do is you open a door where entities can come in, and it's like all the bullying that I experienced at school. Like back then, you could be bullied at school, but you could go home and you didn't have to deal with it anymore. Not like today, like we're on social media and you still can't get away from it. But back then, it's like when I went home, it's like there was a time I had to try to go to sleep at night. And where I had opened that door to things that are not godly, I started to see stuff at the foot of my bed. And what ended up happening was I was seeing these things that like were so horrific. I couldn't sleep at night. Of course, you know, when I go to school the next day, it's like, you know, where I hadn't had any sleep. It's like I eventually got to where I started skipping school. And because where my mom and dad worked, it's like they would leave early in the morning. And, when I would catch the bus, it's like I would hear the bus go up the road. I'd be like, see you, suckers. It's like, I ain't going. So what ended up happening was I failed the eighth grade. And that plan worked for a while, but like I was still struggling with, in that realm of battling with those demons and stuff. And during that time, my mom and dad they separated. And so I just sank deeper and deeper into a depression. And
they had a hold of you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And at that time, this was way before school shootings like happened like they did now. But going through that period of my parents separating, it's like I was kind of going back and forth from my cousin's house. Mm-hmm. And one of the cousins' house I went to, they were gun fanatics. And, you know, one of the things that I struggled with is like those demons always tried to talk me into, well, just take a gun to school. It's like, you know, you'll show them. It's like you'll show them that, you know, they can't push you around. It's like, you know, finally let your voice be heard. Because what would happen is, and I want to say this too, especially for all the kids that have went through this, the hardest thing was not just the demonic side, but the hardest thing was going through that when you see that the teachers see what you're going through and they turn a blind eye.
Yeah. You know,
I went through a period where I felt like my self-worth was nothing. And so when I went through that, it's like I just took on a coat of hate. And it's like I got to the place where if I would have met you back then, I would have chose to hate you before you could ever, you know, figured out it. Yeah. I put up that wall. So like daily when I would spend a lot of time with my cousins, it's like those demons would be like, yeah, take the gun to school, you know, finally take your stand, show them. And and there was a couple times that you know, it was, but by the grace of God, you know. And another period after that, my mom and dad, they would kind of reconcile for a little bit and then split up again before they finally did. One of the aspects that I went through too, with one year for Christmas, my dad had a shotgun purchased for him for for his work's Christmas present. Okay. And so during that time too, it's like I struggled with suicide. And I remember a couple times staring down the barrel of the shotgun, and
they were trying to get you.
Yeah. And because, like, the way my heart was back then, I had no idea what God had in store, even when I was so far away from him. Yeah. I couldn't see, because of the hatred in my heart, I couldn't see, like, what he would ever have for me. Because, like, when you're in that much hate, like, there's an oppression of darkness that comes upon you. It's like you don't want to see the light. Like, even though God is trying to reach you, it's like, you know, I believe sometimes, like, he lets us fall on our back so we have to see him looking up.
And, yeah, I agree with that.
So, and, you know, getting back to my grandmother's, there was a couple times back then we had shop class. And for those in this generation that might not know what that was, it's like, it was like a class where they taught the boys how to build stuff, like in construction and stuff.
Yeah. And
one of the things that I can say, because I don't want to make it all about the enemy, but one of the times that I was being bullied, I was like in this back room where a bunch of lumber was stood up. And one of the times I was pushed in that back room, and there's like a couple other guys like holding me down, and another guy like hitting me in the back with a 2x4. I remember hearing the smacks of the 2x4, but I didn't feel anything, because one of the things that got to my mind at that time, I would hear my grandmother's prayers in the back of my mind. And my Baptist grandmother, she would always like walk around her house singing hymns and stuff. And you know, that was one of the nuggets that God left for me back then that kind of gave me a little bit of hope. But I just wanted to say that, just to let people know that God is in your situation, whether you feel him or not.
Amen.
And so fast forward a little bit. I get through the eighth grade on the second year on my repeat. and everything.
Hard lesson, but you learned it.
Yeah. And the thing that God got through me to was, I went to my other aunt's and uncle's house, and back where I lived back then, we didn't have cable. So we had like only three channels on TV. Mm-hmm. Kind of like, it's like if the president came on, your night was shot, because that's all you could watch. So I went to my other aunt and uncle's house. They had a cable, and I was staying up late at night, and I saw this ministry. It was like a power team ministry where these big muscle guys was like breaking frying pans and doing all this wild stuff. But at the end of it, they had this invitation to come to know Jesus. And it was just me at the TV. And I remember praying that prayer, and I didn't understand it, but I meant it with all my heart. And when I prayed that, it's just like I felt, the only way I can describe it is I felt something break on the inside of me. And I gave my heart to the Lord after that. Now, after I gave my heart to the Lord, it's like I didn't go to church or anything. I didn't have anybody to mentor me. So I didn't really know what to do with what I just received. So, but, you know, the interesting thing too, and you can look this up on the history, like after I went past all that, the year after that in Grayson, Kentucky, there was another student that was the same age I was, that was going through the same thing. And he actually ended up taking the classroom hostage, and there's like news articles and media all about it. But I remember the news report saying that when he took the classroom hostage, that he would yell out like he would yell out to the class, like, how many of y'all believe me now? And And I've talked about the media that I was always consuming back then. Well, come mm-hmm. to find out, he was a Stephen King fanatic. He was a highly mm-hmm. intelligent student, but the only thing that he consumed was like the Stephen King novels. Mm-hmm. And so it's like when I saw that, it's like I knew that we both wrestled with the same demons, but like he yeah. had a different outcome. And so, you know, God helped me come through all that. And then fast forward a few years later, I meet this girl on the internet.
Enters me into the picture.
Listen, God has a design path for people to cross at the yeah. time that we need them. And if we allow them to come in, then he gets to have his way with us in yeah. the way that we're supposed to be interacting with God. I don't believe that anything that God has designed for us is by coincidence, is right. by design.
Absolutely. Now you can but say something.
I had during, you know, our teenage years, I had been in a long-term relationship with my high school sweetheart. And we had been together for 9 years. And at this point, I was 23, graduating college. And I knew that the life plan that God had for me was not with this current fella. Mm-hmm. But it's like what Mickey and I had in common was we did not attend church as a child or a teenager. We knew mm-hmm. who Jesus was, but we didn't know how to live the life of a Christian because we right. didn't have the influence around us. But I knew upon graduation, this was not what, you know, my life trajectory should be. I mean, mm-hmm. I had enough discernment, I guess, on the yeah. inside, even though I wasn't following the Lord. And, mm-hmm. So enters Mickey into the world of dial-up modem, you know. You know, the whole home computer is a new concept. Mm-hmm. You know, you had to dial up and you had to agree to meet at a certain time in a chat room. And yeah. I don't know if chat rooms are still, you know, a thing now that
I don't know if they are, but I do remember. And, you know, could nobody use the phone or anything if you were on the internet. Right. So, yeah, I know.
You know, our youth today are like, dial up. What do you mean? We just get on our tablets. I'm like, yeah, well, yep. then, before you had, there was a whole big process. And so we had met actually in a chat room, and you know, you do your normal, you know, female 23 looking yep. for non-smoker, non-drinker, prefers yep. the church, you know. I think yep. once you put those things,
going yeah, on.
Yeah. I figure once you put all that thing, you're narrowing your list down, you know.
Yeah.
And to those younger that may be listening, it's like everybody's talking in this chat room. So you had to wait until who, you know, you might be talking with to come through the list. You know, mm-hmm. it was like a continual conversation. So finally, yeah. you know, this guy pops in, and you know, it was like we started chatting that way, and like the questions that we were asking each other, we had to wait on the scroll, you know, to find each other. And
yeah,
slow typer. So I'm just like, you know, as a woman, I was like,
she was like, and I was more like,
you hunting and pecking the letters, like up.
So we met, you know, for a couple days. You know, when you say that, it's like a couple days, you know, but it's like we found each other within, you know, millions of people. Mm-hmm. And so we knew that, you know, that was neat, that was definitely unusual. It was fun to talk with him, and he wanted my number forever, and I would not give it to him. You know, I was just like, no, we're fine with chatting.
Then she found out I talked as slow as I typed.
No. Oh, Lord.
So we changed numbers probably after a week or so, because he was getting tired of typing, like, with one finger.
Mm-hmm. And, like, can I just get on the phone with you, because this type, and I'm gonna be till next year trying to tell you one thing.
I can really flex my index muscle.
Our first night, I remembered we were talking up to like 4 a.m. And okay. I could tell we were clicking, and so he's like, so would you want to meet? And I'm like, well, you know, I don't know, you know. And back then you didn't have the opportunity like we do now to just send an instant picture. You had to scan the picture, save it, mm-hmm. from the folder, email it.
The whole process.
I was able to send a picture of myself, but he was not able to send a picture of himself. So I'm like, okay, you know, because it's like, is this real? Or is he just being cheesy, you know?
The thing was, when I saw her picture, I was like, wow, I have no chance with this gal.
So I felt like I was kind of being like blown off, or, you know, I'm like, why won't you send me a picture? Come on, you know, like.
Right.
Didn't have the technical capability to be able to do that. And so he said, so, you know, and all this time it was like, so where are you from? And I'm like, well, I'm from a small town in Eastern Kentucky. And he's like, well, I'm from a small town in Eastern Kentucky. And I'm like, you know, what are the chances, you know, that we were close by? And so he was from one county over, and he actually worked in the city that I was from. And okay. I'm like, okay, this is getting a little weird. At this point, it's getting a little, you know, it's getting
all the way through that from the beginning.
And he did, because what I didn't know was Mickey had, you know, he was tired of being in relationship after relationship, and was praying to God that, you know, he had not accepted yet into his heart, if you send someone, I will serve them with you. And that's what mm-hmm. he spoke with to the Lord. And here I pop up, you know, and it's
just. Yeah, God answered that prayer immediately. And it just took time for you guys to actually come together. Yeah. And that's one thing that I can say about God in prayer, is that sometimes he answers our prayers instantly, but we have to follow the steps and follow the instructions. And sometimes we get so hard-headed and stubborn that we want to still try to do it our way. And he's like, okay, I'm going to let you go ahead and do it your way and see how many times you fall down, and then you'll let me in, and then it'll be an easy shot had you listened to me the first time.
Yeah.
Right. And I'm guilty of that completely. Yep.
And so, you know, as we, he actually says I stalked him first, which I'm like, well, I didn't have a picture. I didn't know.
Well, in fairness, her mom said that I could have been an axe murderer.
She's like, what are you doing in there typing on that computer? You know, I'm like, oh, I'm just talking to a guy. Well, he could be an axe murderer. You don't know who he is, you know.
Yeah, you know, that's what all parents said back then, because you didn't know, and anybody could, and they still kind of do this. They lie about who they are, and then when you actually get in front of them, they're totally opposite of what they said, not even looking like what they look like, because some people will still put up a picture that they took 17 years ago and present it as today, and then you see them in person, and you're like, okay, is this really you? Because it looks nothing like you today. And so, you or know.
Get on the phone with them and say, hey, I think I met your grandmother here.
Yeah. Right. So see, back then the word catfishing wasn't even a terminology. I just went out on faith that who I was meeting was who I was talking
to. Yeah, because that's really all you had is blind faith and trusting the process. Miss Patrice says that she remembers those days. Like, dial up was a whole, like I was telling one of my younger coworkers at work, I was telling her that I don't know if anybody, well, somebody out here has to remember when you had to get the CD from the Walmart, the Net Zero internet or the AOL internet, and you had to go through the whole process of downloading that onto the computer, and then you had to wait, and then you would hear this crazy little sound. And if you tried to use the phone, it would kick you off the internet. And she was so blown away, like, what are you even talking about? And I was like, you can just pick up your phone and you're connected to the internet. That is not how it was. I said, we had sets of encyclopedias at home if we wanted to know information. I said, so y'all have no idea of how easy you guys have it right now. You have everything in the palm of your hand, and some of you still walk around clueless. I don't understand how that works, but it's okay. Eventually you'll get there. But, you know, back then it was one of those things that you're like, okay, eventually we're gonna get to where we are now. And technology has definitely come a long way, but God has been in you guys' story from day one. And he answered those prayers like nobody else could and nobody else would. But I'm also grateful that you guys were obedient to what he was telling you guys to do, because that played a major part in it as well, is being obedient.
And we had not had that background and of church or being a Christian or being around people, believers. It's like we knew that we were destined to be together. We knew that by the circumstances that had stacked up. You know, to this point, we knew that we were supposed to be together. And so we would just, you know, we would pray to God. We knew the Bible was an important part of life, and we started seeking together, and we knew that we would be getting married, and we knew that God had a purpose and a plan for us being married. And so it's kind of like the night that we got saved. Well, going back a little bit, a week before we had got saved, Mickey is a guitarist, so he was playing in a bar, and, you know, on the weekends, that's easy money. And, you know, as his girlfriend, I was going and supporting that. And, you know, I had grown up pretty sheltered, what I call sheltered. I wasn't allowed to go out. I wasn't allowed to cruise around town. I wasn't allowed to have alcohol. And so
so we're talking 21 years old, and we're going to play at the bar, and she's still like, well, I have to be home at 9 o'clock. Yeah. I'm like, what? You're 21 years old.
He's like, what time do you have to be home? I'm like, 9. He's like, well, the show's not over until like 11:30. And I'm like, well, I'll work that out, you know. But it was like, I was feeling a little bit of freedom that I had not had. And so, you know, of course, being a woman in a bar and you're sitting by yourself, you're going to have a lot of drink offers and a lot of hit-ons. And so I never had to pay for any of my drinks. And, you know, there was one night that I was getting a little bit buzzed because I didn't know that you couldn't just drink one right after the other, you know. And so it was like my testimony is that God spoke to me like in my mind right there in the bar. And the best way that I can describe it is like God like brought me back. He zoomed me back and let me see the panoramic view of the room. And he said, you don't belong in this place. I have a greater plan for you. Well, I just sat there and bawled like a baby, and right there in the middle of the bar. And so I'm like, well, I can't do this right here at the table. So I went to the bathroom, and all these girls and women, they're like, oh, honey, did he break up with you? Did he break up? I'm like, no, you don't understand.
That's always the thing.
It's like in my mind, reality was like, you know, it was like, don't tell him God is speaking to you, because like you're right here. I'm under conviction. That's my problem, you know.
Yeah, they all tell you that you really had too much to drink, because that's not it.
So I'm like, you know, and I was just all tore up the rest of the night, you know. And so that following Sunday, we actually, you know, we had made our way to a church. So it was time for the altar call. And the way the seating was, there were two aisles to the altar, and Mickey went one way and I went the other, and we didn't know each other went, because, you know, it's during that time of everybody close your eyes, you know, or raise your hand or come forward. And he went one way or the other. And we had given our lives to the Lord together, but didn't know it. And so that was a really special moment.
Oh, yeah. Well, listen, I'm grateful that you guys have given the backstory, because it definitely shows the battle that you went through to get through where you are. Because I can honestly say for me, and where I'm at right now on my spiritual journey, is that I used to be such a fan of like the scary movies and things of that nature. Because number one, my birthday is October the 29th. So October is my favorite month, and Halloween. However, now that I've gotten older, I can't even find myself watching no scary movies anymore, because I know what they entailed and what they had to go through to create those movies. So now, even, you know, I watched them all the time as a kid growing up, but within these last 5 years, I cannot find the space in where I would even sit down and watch one now, you know, because it doesn't appeal to me in the same manner in which it did. And I'm grateful for the closeness now that I have with God in being able to decipher from that, you know, because I loved a scary movie. I loved Halloween. I loved all of those things. And, you know, I still love the month of October, because that's my month, but I celebrate a little differently now, you know. But God has a way of putting you through certain things and allowing you to walk this earth in a way to where you get away from him. But I think it's the moments where we are in silence where we actually can hear from him. And it's like he's always with us and he's walking with us. But when we choose to not hear him, that is where it feels like that distance has gotten really far and in between, when it's like, no, I never went anywhere. I've been here through everything, but you chose not to hear me when I was speaking clearly to you. Absolutely. And yeah, so I think that's one of the things that people are, well, God don't hear me. No, God heard you. Yeah. Are you listening for him is the question. And that's the question most of us don't ever want to answer, because it's like, no, I've been talking to God for years and he ain't heard nothing that I said, because he let me go through all of this. But he had to let you go through those things. And I feel like if God showed us a preview of what we had to go through to get the prayers answered, we would quickly say, nah, I don't want none of that. I don't want to be a part of that. You know, like, if I got to go through this, if I got to fall down and break my arm and my leg, I don't want to have to do that, because there's pain that comes with that. And I don't want to have to endure the pain. But in order for you to endure the joy of what you go through, you have to endure the pain as well to come out on the other side. And we don't want to hurt for anything, but God is not in the business of hurting you to hurt you. He's in the business of helping to build you and to share his greatness with the world. And if you're allowing him to do so, nothing that you go through is ever in vain. It's always for a greater good.
Yes,
absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I totally agree. I believe all of us, we're on that journey, but every one of us will have that experience like Jacob did, because Jacob was a trickster, but eventually he had to wrestle with the Lord. And after he got done wrestling with the Lord, his walk was totally different.
Never the same.
Yep.
And everybody that met Jacob after that, after he wrestled with the Lord, they knew that he had been in the presence of the Lord. He didn't have to just talk about the Lord. They knew he was with the Lord because they saw the way he walked.
When God gets his hands on you, your walk is different. Your talk is different. Your delivery, your presence, your aura, everything about you becomes different. And people who have been with you from childhood, they will quickly tell you, oh, well, you're acting different. You changed. You did this. You did that. And it's like, okay. And that's what I was supposed to do. I was supposed to change. I was supposed to grow. The way that I view the world now is not the same through the eyes of a little girl. And I can honestly say some of the things that I've been through in my life, my mom, she was addicted to drugs and alcohol, said some very hurtful things to me as a kid growing up. One of the most hurtful things was that she wished that I was dead. She told me that when I was 12 years old. Mm-hmm. Now, the thing about that is, me being the kid that I was and the person that I am now, I still have a smart mouth. And so I made my mom was so mad with me because she didn't know how to respond. Right. And so when she said to me that I wish you was dead, I said, oh my goodness, who made you mad today? I said, but I think it's kind of late for you to want to kill me. I said, because that would be murder. And I don't think you want to do that. But, you know, whatever you decide, it's your choice, but I don't think murder would look good on your record. And so my mom was like, just get away from me. And I was like, okay, fine. I didn't do anything to you. I just came to speak, but you're already mad, but okay. But, you know, it was one of those hurtful things that you hear as a kid. And I saw a lot of domestic violence with my mom and her boyfriends and things of that nature. And people would always wonder, you know, why I was never angry and bitter with my mom was because my mom had to fight her own battles. Yeah. But it wasn't anything that I could do, was only be supportive. And but I also had to learn to set boundaries in how I dealt with my mom. And, you know, I'm grateful because God allowed me the time and the space to be with her in her final months. And one of my biggest prayers was to never let my mom die alone. Don't let her be out in the streets and not be to where family is there. And it was a hard journey, but I was able to be with my mom when she took her final breath last year. But, you know, all of the things that I've been through, the things that I've experienced, the hurt, the pain, the betrayal of family and friends, things of that nature, I don't carry any hatred or bitterness towards anybody. And I owe that to God, because when I start to tell people the things that have been done to me, I should be angry. I should be bitter according to what people would say because of what they've done. But I have no desire to be hurtful or to be vindictive or to seek revenge. I had a cousin of mine that I considered really close. And it was a lie that she told on me. And all I could do was just laugh at it, because it was a lie that was told to my niece about my ex-mother-in-law and my daughter. And it was that she said that I had called them some names. And if you know me, if I said it once, I'll say it twice. I'm not going to say anything about anybody behind their back that I can't repeat to their face. Yeah. And so I had gotten a promotion and gotten a better job for the hospital. Well, my cousin, she had applied for a job for a hospital, but she ended up lying on her credentials, so she got fired from the hospital. Well, shortly after that is where I started working for the hospital after I graduated from college. And it got back to me. And so my ex-mother-in-law was asking everyone except for me, had I said something? And so when I finally went to confront my ex-mother-in-law about it, I was like, you know, you had this question, but instead of coming to me to find out the answer, I said, you've known me since I was 15 years old. If I've ever said anything once, you know, I'll say it twice. I said, so why didn't you just come and ask me? And so she was like, well, I don't know. I said, you have my phone number. You have my address. You knew where I was. I said, but it took you for me to come to you to say anything about this. I said, and it just goes to show that you wanted to believe what was said about me, because that's how you always felt about me. I said, and that's fine. You're entitled to feel that way. I said, but since you didn't come and ask me, let me go ahead and clarify some things for you. But the cousin that did that, I haven't spoken to her. She's avoided me at all costs. And it's like, you avoided a situation that you caused. I'm not angry with you and I'm not upset with you. But I don't even really want to know why, but it goes to show that people that you have, that you feel are closest to you, will betray you when they are upset about a decision that they made in their lives and it has nothing to do with you. And so I'm just like, you know, people are going to be who they are. They're going to tell you that you've changed when you start walking with God. Mm-hmm. Yes, your walk is different. The people that you entertain is different. The things that you go through in life is going to be different, but it's because you're walking with a purpose now. That's and right. You're starting to understand what your purpose is and where right. you go. I used to run away from what we're doing right now. I will be honest with you, yeah. but I realized just the other day that what I do is what God has called me to do. I had a young lady come in the office. I work in an urgent care facility. And the young lady came in and she was explaining, you know, what she was going through and everything. And as she finally made it to the back, saw our provider, as she got ready to leave, she came back and she was telling me about being able to see again. Now, that's not the reason why she came into the office. It was for something else. But she came as she was leaving. She was like, I just needed to come by and tell you, you know, that I'm just overly excited and grateful that because she hadn't been able to see her twin boys for months because she was starting to lose her sight. And so she had said that she had been praying and talking to God and everything. And, you know, she was just grateful for that moment. But she said she felt like she needed to tell me that because I would be one who would understand the blessing that she has. Mm-hmm. And it let me know that when strangers talk to me, I'm in the space in which God has called me to be. And I let people vent to me, say whatever they need to say, because sometimes all they need is a listening ear. Right. And then, you know, for her to say that about me, it was like, you know, God, I hear you. That was my confirmation for the day that she really needed somebody to understand that she received a blessing. And she was like, I don't know what it is, but I feel like you can understand how going from one situation when you're dealing with your health to another situation, you can understand when God is blessing you through that. And I didn't explain to her that how I knew, but I said, yes, ma'am, you're exactly right that I do understand because of my own issues with my health, and understood what she meant. So, but you know, we will talk all night about the goodness of God, but I'm not going to keep you guys any longer because, you know, God is just one of those things. And I know I talk to him all the time, and I know sometimes he puts me on hold because I'm constantly talking to him, asking him questions. And he's like, okay, look here, you don't ask me 17 questions. Can you go to sleep? We'll talk again tomorrow. Yeah, so you know, when you have a, people always laugh at me when I say that, but I'm like, that's how much I talk to God, and He knows the child that He created. I'm gonna be on the line, and so I'm like, Jesus, don't put me on hold right now. I got some questions, so come on and answer. I don't want to talk to Jacob. I don't want to talk to Paul. I don't want to talk to none of them. I'm gonna talk to you, but you're gonna put me on hold, so I'll come back. I'll let you do what you need to do, but I'm gonna be back.
I like that. That gave me a good visual because, you know, I know that sometimes the Lord, I know he never slumbers or sleeps, you know, but I think sometimes he makes you sleepy so that you'll go to sleep.
So you'll get tired. If you see me down on the call ID, I don't talk to her 12 times already. I'm not talking to her no more. Tell her to go to sleep. Just go, you sleeping right now. Just go to bed. I'll talk to you tomorrow. But I really and truly thank you guys for being here tonight. And we definitely will have to have a conversation again. Yeah, and absolutely. How can people get in touch with you guys?
Go ahead.
We on Facebook, we are Free at Last Podcast, and you can go on there, and we have a weekly live that we do, and we talk about issues that the church necessarily won't discuss on a Sunday morning. So it's, you know, we do topics that people have questions to, and, you know, we kind of hit some tough topics, you know, and so that's always been fun. But the Free at Last Podcast on Facebook, and we have a website, the Free at Last
Ministries.org.
And we're on Instagram and
YouTube.
And we've finally in the last year brought all of our branding together for the Free at Last Podcast.
Pray for us to pray for us to work smarter, not harder.
Yeah. Listen, it always starts when you start one of these things, when God gives you the direction of what to do, it seems very chaotic. And then once you get everything in working order, you can streamline it. But He gives you the vision. He gives you the provisions to make sure that it happens. And then He's able to let you streamline it so everything is not so all over the place. Yeah. I am one to believe that. Because I started a publishing business almost 2 years ago, and now I'm slowly starting to streamline all of this. I've been doing the podcast now a little over a year, so everything is in its own space, but then it's slowly starting to come together. So I definitely understand completely, and you guys will definitely be in my prayers. And one thing that I always say before I leave any show, and that is, stay out of God's business. The only thing that God needs you to do is be obedient to what He's called you to do. So until next time, yes, ma'am. Until next time, I will see you guys on May 23rd, where my guest will be Miss Latoya Jackson. And you don't want to miss her because she is a student of God's word. Amen. All right. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Y'all have a great night and happy Mother's Day.
Oh, mercy me. Oh, things ain't what they used to be now. Where did all the blue sky